Yes.
So one of the occasional diseases which we see in our retina clinic is myopic traction maculopathy. It's a very subtle finding, which is usually only picked up clearly on OCT. Especially when you have a high myopia patient with unexplained vision loss, always don't hesitate to do a OCT to visualize the posterior pole disorders. Here I'm showing you various degrees of a myopic traction myopathy, or MTM as it's popularly called. You can see here the early taut posterior hyoid phase is there. And here you can see the early effects of the traction on the inner surface of the retina. And you can hear in the top picture, you can see the early skytic changes, and which is getting more and more increase in these eyes. You are seeing a significant amount of myopic macular sclerosis in the top picture. In the bottom picture, you have a posterior pole RD with a myopic sclerosis and a large macular hole as well. So various names have been given to the entity, but now right now, MTM or myopic traction maculopathy is one of the more popularly used terminology here. Here you can see a myopic CNVM along with the myopic macular sclerosis. We can see a very well delineated dot. Macular space, splitting of the inner layer into thin strips. Various theories have been proposed, but main thing is that traction from the taut interlimiting membrane, from the blood vessels, taut in short retina, and also the elongated sclera, which is not conformed to the retinal curvature. So all these have been proposed as causes for this traction maculopathy. So various techniques have been described to take care of this. First has been the vitrectomy with the internal limiting membrane, peeling by Panozzo et al. They showed that peeling the internal limiting membrane helped to relieve the traction and attach the macula. In some of these cases, it took a long time period to reattach the retina. Following this, Spade proposed that only the hyoid phase is a more important structure clinically, and he demonstrated a success in patients where he did not remove the ILM and remove known as a aiding agent. And here, there is not the presence of the posterior skytic, which is almost transparent and very thin. You can see here there's a posterior pole RD of the large macular hole. We have put already a PFCL bubble there inside, and I'm staining the ILM using BBG dye under the PFCL. Here I'm picking up the ILM and trying to peel, and I realize that at this point there's something which hindering a transparent membrane, as you can see there, and that is the residual hyoid phase, posterior phase, which is very thin and transparent, unlike what you would normally see in a routine patient. So in almost all high myopic patients, what feels like a PVD is not truly a PVD. Now I'm peeling the ILM after the peeling of the hyoid. So always make sure that you identify the thin hyoid membrane below the so-called PVD. So always assume that this membrane is there and address it. Also, some people have tried supporting by placing various types of pills, from PROM to the Morbid Devin implant, and all, as well as you use the silicone sponge, dental wires, just showing the Andos PROM surgery. You can see after doing a vitrectomy internal membrane peeling, here is the endolimiter to aid in the central placement right beneath the fovea. And this is the PROM, which is sutured, the arms of the PROM are just sutured just below the lateral lectus. And you can see the light lighting up that indicates the correct position. Two temporal portion will support, two nasal portion can include the optic nerve. Some of the pictures of success following surgery. So this one case where people are not well versed in macular buckle, we can do an intentional retinal slit. This is one of our cases who came with a posterior pole RD with the myopic macular sclerosis, and after vitrectomy, she developed actually the preoperative posterior cephaloma, and postoperatively she developed detachment with the large detachment with the iatrogenic macular hole. And this is a surgical video showing the so here we did an intentional almost temporal 180 degree vitrectomy, and then inferior and temporal retinectomy to release the retina, now for intentional slippage. and the ILM was very thin and I was not able to peel it clear. So we just did the retinal graft. You can see the trimming of the peripheral retina, inferior retina, and then dragging this onto the fovea and using this as a retrograft to block the hole. And this is the laser of the image. And this is the post-operative picture showing the large retinectomy and the attached. This is the OCT showing the attached retina. And now the retina is conforming to the deep staphyloma because we have created intentional retinal slippage. So all these techniques can have been described and can be used to address this etiology. Next is the optic disc pit. Again, it's not a very common disorder, but we're going to see it often in pure retina practice. And the success has not been that very great with the conventional techniques. Many things have been tried. The source of the sciatic vitreous fluid, it enters the intraretinal space through the defect in the optic nerve. So people are various, but the seepage from the vitreous into the intraretinal subretinal. People try to laser the temporal edge of the ONHP and the variable structures, but not that very great. And also people have tried using gas into the vitreous cavity by own pushing to take care of this tamponade the optic nerve pit, and varied success and reported technique also. People done vitrectomy with gas, with the ILM peeling, with the ILM graft over the like this. First, initially only plain ILM peeling was done. ILM grafting as well as scleral grafting. Spade also, in one of the cases, they described the inner retinal fissures creating multiple retinotomies at the bundle area to allow the fluid to exit back into the vitreous cavity. So various sealants have been used and now commonly prefers the ILM graft and then the scleral graft here. You can see here, the ILM is just linked onto the optic disc. So this is a fovea involving ILM peeling, which you can go into iatrogenic macula. This case. So nowadays we started to do a fovea sparing ILM peeling to avoid this iatrogenic macular hole. So this one gets a child around 10 years old boy. So you can see the ILM staining and the fovea sparing flap, which is then lifted onto the optic disc pit and then gas is injected to tamponade this. So more recently, the best success has been with the placed scleral graft on the this. We have seen better success compared to ILM flap. We have to fashion the graft according to the size of the pit and then this pushed into the optic disc pit and then either oil or tamponade is done depending upon the age group. So there's some of the successes following surgery. And last is the subretinal PFC. So migration can happen in the presence of large breaks, posterior breaks, a taut retina where the retina inherence is or because of a sense of extensive proliferative membrane which has not been addressed, bubbling due to intraocular pressure or due to exchange instruments, and also a very gross retina during surgery. We can see that the during exchange of instruments, see the presence of bubble here, and then this can small bubbles can migrate. So how to this once when you see in the postoperative period, the ideal time is to remove as early as possible. So this can go to permanent scota if it is left alone. The commonest technique, very small bubble, is to iatrogenic bullae of RD by injecting BSS in the submacular space and then using the tip trying to push this into the central cavity. And when you're trying to aspirate, this can be removed with suction cannula. So here you can see we have a 49 gauge Med1 needle, you can use that to inject to create the RD. If they don't have a Med1 needle, you can use the 30 gauge needle, which is hooked onto a 24 gauge needle, and you can create your own contrapture. Here you can see that the BSS is injected slowly into the submacular space, and once then mobilize the PFCL bubble into the center of the bullae, then we aspirate and come out on its own. Second technique is if the large hole, we can directly aspirate here. If it's a large hole, we can directly make a nick at the edge of the I don't because it's difficult to remove. You can create inferior bullae and then push the PFC bull into the central and allow the patient to sit so that the gravitational and the pressure will push it from up to down. And then you pull the bubble. So it will be, even though it is in the macula, it will be off the fovea, which is the critical zone. So all techniques can be tried for dealing with the pain subretinal PFC. Thank you.